Welcome to MedTalk, presented by Medical Crypt. We have Dr. Sharad Joshi, who is Associate Director Pulmonology at Max Vaishali. On this World Lung Cancer Day, we'll have some awareness on what is lung cancer, what are the risk factors, and how to diagnose it, or what are the screening tests available. So we'll be talking about it. So welcome, Dr. Sharad.
Thank you. Thank you, Anzi.
So on this World Lung Cancer Day, we thought of giving the awareness of what is lung cancer. So what is lung cancer?
So actually, we need to understand what actually is the cancer, right? So cancer is a group of cell which doesn't obey any command. So there are cells in our body and they group together to do a particular or certain set of function. Like the WBCs or white cells, they try to protect us from bacteria, viruses, fungi, and other allergens. So these are WBC or white cells. There are skin cells which protect us from all the environment. And whenever these naturally functioning normal cells, they age, they are replaced, they die a natural death, and they are replaced by other cells. So if you talk about platelets in the blood, which have a function of clotting or clot formation in the blood, whenever you get injury. So the lifespan of a platelet is just 72 hours. So after 72 hours, every platelet is replaced by a new platelet. And the old platelets or the old cells which are dying, they get a natural death, which is called apoptosis. And their raw material is used again for building the other part or other cells of the body. So this is a natural generation or a natural cell cycles where our new cells regenerated, old cells die by apoptosis or natural death, and they are replaced. But in a cancer tissue, these cells don't function. They don't follow these genetic command of a natural death, and they multiply uninhibited. They enormously multiply and they don't function anything. So what happens is actually they eat up all the nutrition which our human body is getting. So that's the group of cells which is a cancer cell. Now, the cancer can affect any part of the body. So whenever the cancer cell is affecting lungs, it is lung cancer. Now, lung cancers can be a primary lung cancer that originated from the cells inside the lungs, or it can be a metastatic lung cancer which has originated from other body part and has traveled to lungs. Like in a female, a breast cancer in a later stage can travel to lungs. So that will be a lung deposit of a breast cancer. Okay. So there are different things, like in a human being, a renal cell carcinoma or a type of cancer of kidney can actually travel to lung and can cause metastasis and malfunction of the lungs. So that will be metastasis from renal function, renal tumor. So these kind of different lung cancers are there. And a cancer cell is unruly cell. You can call it, it's a rebel, which doesn't follow your rules of recycling and natural death. And then it multiplies, eats up you all. All right.
What are the risks for lung cancer?
That's a very difficult question to answer because we know n number of risk factors for developing cancers and we know n number of risk factors for developing lung cancer. But there are still incidences of lung cancer in patients who don't show any or who don't have any risk behavior. So the commonest risk factor for all kind of cancer is one of them is smoking or tobacco consumption. That's the commonest risk factor for lung cancer. Unfortunately, in last 5 to 10 years period, we have seen lung cancer increasing in non-smoking population. So these patients, they are non-smoker. They haven't used tobacco in any form in their life, but they still develop lung cancer. And the other risk factors are environmental because lungs are exposed to enormous amount of air, which we breathe in, breathe out every moment. If you talk about just 24 hours, we actually inhale thousands of liters of air inside. We consume oxygen out of it and we exhale carbon dioxide out of it. But while we are inhaling oxygen, we are trying to consume oxygen, we inhale other risk factors, other risk components of the pollution. So air pollution is another very important component. So like methane gas, like carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, sulfuric acid or sulfur dioxide, all these gases, ozone, all these gases actually can lead to lung cancer. So as the pollution is rising in the urban cities, it will definitely lead to increase in not only lung cancer, but other incidences of the cancers also. Then apart from smoking and inhaling a polluted air, there are occupational hazards like arsenic, asbestos, benzene. There are n number of chemicals which are used, or sulfuric gases, acidic gases from the sulfuric acid. All these chemicals can actually lead to development of lung cancer. So it will be more associated with certain set of occupations, like people who are working in brick factory or people who are working in fireproofing industry. So these people are exposed to certain chemicals and they will develop lung cancer. But I remember very well a quotation from my pathology head. And once, almost like 20 years, 25 years ago, he said that if any human being thinks that he should not get lung cancer, there is only one way, that you don't take birth on earth. So honestly, risk, it's the just existence of you as a human being can actually is a risk factor for lung cancer. But that doesn't mean that everybody has to be scared and just put on three air purifiers in your room and don't come out of it. But you have to, education or knowledge is actually the light which will help you fight this problem. Okay.
What are the symptoms of lung cancer? How do we know? I mean, like, what are the symptoms so that we can do a screening?
For general population, we need to understand that lung diseases will have a limited set of symptoms. Right. So these are patients, even if they have got pneumonia, tuberculosis, or fluid inside the lung, or there is an abscess in the lung, these are chronic diseases. They will have cough, breathlessness, chest pain, bringing out blood in the sputum. These kind of symptoms are mostly common symptoms of all lung diseases. And that is the reason that people keep on ignoring them to be not a lung cancer rather than being something else. We carried out a study in our hospital and we found out that almost 70% of lung cancer patients had been on some kind of drugs or some kind of medicines for other lung diseases like tuberculosis or bronchiectasis or asthma. So this is the reason that these symptoms can actually misguide you towards another lung disease. Therefore, if you have any chest disease for a long standing duration, like 4 weeks or 6 weeks, and if you have any other risk factor, even the genetic tendency is a risk factor for lung cancer. So it should be thoroughly evaluated. You should always consult a chest physician or an oncologist or a specialized doctor and evaluate.
What are the types of lung cancer?
So initially, at the start of my talk, I said that primary lung cancer, which originate from the lung, and the others are the cancers which develop in other body organs and travel to lung cancer. But if you talk about primary lung cancers, broadly they are divided into small cell cancer and non-small cell lung cancers. And small cell lung cancers are actually only, they contribute to just 15 to 20% of lung cancers. Majority of them are non-small cell lung cancers. And out of non-small cell lung cancer, there are subtypes like squamous cell carcinoma, there is adenocarcinoma, there is large cell carcinoma, then there is poorly differentiated carcinoma or bronchoalveolar cell carcinoma. So there are different varieties, but there have been some associations that smokers are more often associated with squamous cell carcinoma. They are mostly centrally located. And non-smokers are more prone to get adenocarcinoma. What the trend previously was that lung cancer was more prevalent in male population. It was more prevalent in smokers. But now in last 10-15 years, the trend has changed. We are getting more number of adenocarcinomas than squamous cell carcinomas. And we are getting more patients who are non-smokers, who are not consuming tobacco. And there are more female patients who are affected by lung cancer. So there are variety of lung cancer. The importance for a layman for their variety or their type of cancer is that the treatment line will be different according to the type of the cancer.
So what are the screening tests that we do for lung cancer?
So we'll not confine just for the screening test. We'll talk about all the diagnostic tests which are required for a lung cancer. So any cancer, in the body or in the lung needs two things to be definitive for starting a treatment for the cancer. One thing is type of the cancer, and the other thing is stage of the cancer. And the third most important component is what is the physical condition of patient. So say there is a patient who is in advanced lung cancer, and his type of cancer is that there is metastasis, so it is stage 4, and it is adenocarcinoma. But the patient's general physical condition is very, very weak or very, very sick. So this patient is not going to tolerate the chemotherapy. In that particular scenario, maybe the oncologist or the entire tumor board decides that patient should be given a palliative care rather than giving them toxic chemotherapy. So we come back to diagnosis of lung cancer. And first and foremost thing is that patient should not ignore their symptoms. So any patient who has undue chest pain, which is not explained, which is not correlated with any trauma, blood in the sputum, these are two very, very important symptoms and they should not be ignored ever. Then there are subtle symptoms like a persistent cough, which can be productive, which can be dry. Or there are symptoms like bringing out phlegm, and or there is clubbing, or there can be extra pulmonary or symptoms beyond the lungs, because there are certain chemicals which cause symptoms, and there can be a tumor inside the lung, which is compressing the arteries or the vessels of the chest. And in that case, the patient will develop swelling of the face, congestion, redness of the skin, or swelling in the neck. So these kind of symptoms, like superior vena cava syndrome, we call it in professional term, it should not be ignored. There can be clubbing. So their nails will be rounded up, or the nail and the bed of the nail will swell. So these kind of symptoms are in the advanced lung cancer. They should not be ignored. Okay. So any such a thing which is a new development should not be ignored, should be evaluated. Secondly, in a tumor which is inside the lung and is compressing the airway, what will happen is that this compression of airway will lead to reduction in the clearance of secretions. In that particular scenario, there is a tumor which is compressing the airway, but because of this compression in the distal lung, there is development of pneumonia. So these symptoms, the patient will get symptoms of pneumonia. All right. So this will be overlap. Now, the doctor and even the patient will be confused that I am getting fever, I am getting purulent or yellow sputum. So these are symptoms of typical pneumonia. Why you are considering, or why you want to differentiate it from cancer? But it's actually, these kind of cancers can be misguiding. These kind of symptoms can be overlapping. Therefore, thorough evaluation. So first thing is symptoms and sign. The second thing is that radiology. It can be an X-ray. It can be a CT scan of the chest. In rare cases, it can be a contrast CT scan. And definitely to find out what is the stage of lung cancer, we have to go ahead with the PET CT scan. But mind it, imaging will tell you the site or the location or the appearance of a lung cancer or appearance of a tumor. But to know the exact nature, we need a biopsy. And there is, by your medium, I like to disseminate this information that there is a lot of misconception regarding biopsy. Whenever a doctor in his practice, in his clinic, tells the patient that we need a biopsy, they have one particular question that, doctor, I am ready for biopsy, but do you think that this biopsy is not going to increase my disease? So mind it, biopsy is to help you to find out what type of disease we are fighting with. It is not going to increase your disease. So if we don't take a biopsy, we can never be certain of the type of your cancer, and we'll never be certain of your disease and the what medicines we can give you. So biopsy is a must. Biopsy is required, and it is for helping you. It doesn't have any negative effect on you. One thing. Secondly, if a tumor or a lung cancer is located abutting your chest wall, it is nearer the chest wall, then it is easy. You will be subjected to a CT scan and a needle will be inserted through the chest wall and a biopsy will be taken. But in cases when the tumor is inside deep and it is around the airway, definitely the bronchoscopy or endobronchial ultrasound or EUS, such kind of procedures will be required. That will be under sedation endoscopy, and your biopsy will be taken from the airway. But mind it is a painless procedure. There is nothing to be scared of. The doctors, may it be the chest specialist or physicians or interventionist or the oncologist, they are for the help of the patient. They understand the pain a patient is going through and they try to help the patient. So first thing is that patient should have faith in his treating doctor. And this is how we proceed for a diagnosis of lung cancer.
What are the treatments available for lung cancer?
So once we are certain about three things, that the condition of patient is preserved, he is not very sick, and we know the type of cancer, that whether it is squamous cell carcinoma or it is adenocarcinoma or it is a small cell cancer or it is a metastatic lung cancer, and it is not affecting pleura or there is not large collection of fluid inside the airway, and we know the stage of the disease, then only the oncologist or the cancer specialist will decide that treatment of lung cancer or chemotherapy or radiotherapy, or in advanced cases, it can be immunotherapy or a combination of these therapies. And patients who doesn't respond to these treatment, they will be subjected to higher medicines or second line chemotherapy or second line immunotherapy. So there is a variety of treatment for available for cancer that will depend on type of and stage of the cancer. The very important another thing is that there might be stages where treatment cannot be offered, and in those situations there are palliative care. Palliative care is which is trying to reduce your symptom, which is trying to reduce the agony of a patient, like reducing their pain, reducing their breathlessness, reducing their blood in the sputum, improving their performance, improving their nutrition and body strength. So these palliative cares also have a very important role to play in the treatment of lung cancer. All right.
So what are the few points that you want to tell the people out there on this lung cancer day?
Look, when we exactly and 100% doesn't know what are the risk factor for lung cancer, the disease is more better to be prevented than treated. We know that the incidence of disease is rising. As a scientific estimate, in 2020, almost 7 lakh new cases of lung cancer were added in the country. So every year, if this much of number, large number of cases of lung cancer are being added, it's a dangerous thing. And it's a painful agony for the entire mankind, because it's not the patient only who is suffering, it's the entire family which is attached to the patient which is suffering. Therefore, in your capabilities, there are modifiable risk factors that you stop smoking, you stop consuming alcohol, you stop consuming tobacco, try to improve the environment. Whatever measures we can take to control the air pollution should be taken. And it's not about the outdoor air pollution. We should also take care of indoor or inside house air pollution. All these things are very important. The people who are working in a risk industry, who are handling the carcinogenic material like benzene or arsenic or asbestos, or they should take proper care. They should use breathing mask so that they are spared. They are taking care of it. Whether it is coal tar or it is coal combustion fumes, they should be taken care. They should wear and use personal protective devices very thoroughly. So this is on the part of prevention. The second part, which is very important for patients to understand, is that by closing the eyes, a pigeon can fool himself, but the cat is not gone. So important thing is keep your eyes open. Don't try to ignore your symptoms. Consult a qualified doctor. Try to combat your problem with the help of the medical facilities which are available and which are developing every day. Together we can win. So there is nothing to fear of, but we should talk openly, we should approach, we should reach out to find help. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Sharad, for joining us.